This rules out the possibility of a draw, which means whoever wins this last game will secure the second runner-up position in Ucypher. So have a look at the magical game that holds the fate of our teams right now. Dota 2.
The Marksmen and the Akramaks will take the main stage for the last time at Ucypher Season 1. Both these teams are going home, but one will go away a little richer. I'm CloudX, and with me is Vivek, and we're watching the third, fourth place matchup at Ucypher Season 1. Marksmen on the Radiant, Akramaks on the Dio. Talk to me, Vivek, who's going to take this one?
Based on how Akramaks performed in the last game, I want to say Akramaks are the team that have found their groove. The Marksmen, if I'm not mistaken, are on a huge streak of losses. They haven't found any sort of recovery after their initial burst of momentum. And this is the Akramaks lineup that has worked in the past. Worked so well, actually, that Marksmen have banned out the Tinier.
And as things stand, this is the tiebreaker of sorts for the day. There's not going to be another matchup after this, which means the winner of Dota is the winner of the third place prize at Ucypher this time around. Marksmen, they've got the first two picks on the board. They're fighting up against a Night Stalker. Like you mentioned, I love the tiny ban coming out. If you don't know how to deal with it this early on, just ban it out while you can. They're going to respond with an Omni Knight and a Pudge pickup as their first two. They're on the main stage to have some fun while they win some money. And honestly, I think the best strategies that have worked so far on the stage are the ones where the teams seem to be enjoying themselves.
A lot of teams around the world right now have been picking the Omni Knight. Off late, Newbie did it versus Mineski at the Perfect World Masters, if I'm not mistaken. And they had so much success with it. There were no answers to the Omni Knight and the kind of sustain he was providing, the core Timbersaw, that Mineski in Game 2 of that series just banned out the Omni Knight in the first phase.
There's also the fact that Diffusal Blade no longer purges Repel, doesn't purge anything for that matter, which means that Omni Knight is nigh unkillable if he's got a Repel upon himself.
Then you got to think of other ways of dealing with that Repel or that Guardian Angel. Shadow Demon does remove Guardian Angel with Demonic Purge. You got the Oracle as well, if I'm not mistaken. But the Akramaks, they're going to pick up the Underlord. Now, the last time we spoke to Marksmen was after their defeat to Sherdils in Dota. And they had to go into a tiebreaker, and they sort of lost the game of Counter-Strike versus the Sherdils as well. And I remember talking to Red, and Red did mention that they wanted the Underlord in that series. Now, they said that this is a hero they practiced a lot with. Unfortunately, it's going to get denied once more. And everybody's just starting to catch on to how powerful the Akramaks is. Marksmen are going to ban out the Earth Spirit. Now, that's... it's an understandable ban. He's strong in the meta. Blue Frog has only played him once without much success. But hey, the Marksmen, they're not taking their chances.
I mean, we did see Khans basically schooling the Marksmen with the Underlord. So I'm not surprised that Akramaks has taken a page out of that playbook and picked him up immediately. They've got two tanky heroes as their first two picks. Nightstalker, fairly hard to kill. In addition to being tanky, he's also mobile during the nighttime. Underlord, supremely difficult to kill with the Atrophy Aura. That said though, Marksmen does have a potential support duo that could take out the Underlord. Now, it's unconventional to run the Omni Knight and the Pudge as supports because they're both sort of greedy in the sense that they both need levels and a little bit of farm. Pudge, not so much farm, more the EXP.
I'm thinking this is going to be an offlane Omni Knight.
I'm actually thinking this is going to be a dual offlane with the Omni Knight and the Pudge.
That could work.
With farm priority to the Omni Knight.
That could work. Akramaks, I like the second set of bans coming up from them. They're reading the possibility of a Shadow Demon Luna. Shadow Demon and Pudge, not the strongest supporting duo because, hey, after Disruption, there are a bunch of illusions and it makes it immensely hard to connect hooks.
You do end up blocking your own
blocking your own hook. OD could work, though, for the Marksmen if they want to pick it up in the mid lane. We have seen lineups built around the Omni Knight that might make up of an Audi and a Drow. Mirana Banya, not sure what this is telling us. But Marksmen, they're just going to ban up the Mirana. Have Akramaks played a lot? Yeah, Make Believe did play a lot of Mirana.
He's played a fair bit.
Of late, he's been playing the one position.
They've been switching up the roles quite a bit, though, with Akramaks. You know, we kind of thought they found their groove earlier on in the elimination match, but it wasn't meant to be. Mm-hmm. The problem that they still seem to face time and again is they have this innate inability to end games. Both teams, for that matter.
Yeah.
Marksmen and Akramaks have not been able to go onto the high ground. It's sort of as if there's a fear that's restricting them from going up and sieging the base. It's an unjustified fear, because there's not much that changes apart from the vision disadvantage and a little bit of extra damage coming out from the tower. If your basic tenets are in place, if you've got a hero that can dish out damage on the towers, there's an easy way to siege the buildings without having to wait for Roshan time and again. Now, both the auto-win heroes at Ucypher have been banned, the Spectre and the Medusa, so we may not see a game that goes into the absurd wee hours of the morning.
Yeah.
But Marksmen have picked themselves up a Pudge and an Omni Knight, which kind of puts them on a clock. These are heroes that come online in the mid-game, they're heroes that love to fight in the mid-game stage. They're going to get a Witch Doctor, not exactly a hero that scales too well into the late-game stages, especially given it's a 5 and he's unlikely to pick up an Aghanim Scepter.
I think Witch Doctor is the correct fight to pick here for the Marksmen. Maldek should do well versus the Underlord. They've got a bunch of one positions that could punish the Underlord in lane. You could go with the Ursa, go with the Monkey King, Razor, whole lot of options. Whatever the Marksmen want to choose. I mean, that pool's been left open nearby the Akramaks and their next set of bans. So it's sort of clear that we won't be seeing any Shadow Demon Luna or Shadow Demon Terrorblade. Just a reasonably well-rounded draft from the Marksmen. Not sure who this Omni Knight is going to be buffing up just yet. But yeah, so far, decent picks coming out from the Marksmen. And the Akramaks, they respond with the Tinker.
I mean, there's more. Both the Pudge and the Witch Doctor are viable candidates to be buffed up with a Repel this game.
Yeah.
Witch Doctor, you Repel him, you can't stop the channeling of the Death Ward. You Repel the Pudge, he doesn't take damage from his own rot. But now, I think the prime candidate would be the Storm Spirit. You want to have that Storm secure from the Night Stalker Crippling Fear. You've got the Storm to jump in on the Tinker. Marksmen pick it up almost immediately, though, which means that we could still see a Lifestealer pick coming out as their final pick. Mm-hmm. That would give them the Infest Bomb potential, that would give them the physical DPS. And Lifestealer is not bad versus the Underlord. Feast is based on percentage, it's based on his current HP percentage. So, Underlord's one of those that has a high HP pool. Why the hell not?
Yeah, I like the Lifestealer pick up for the Marksmen.
I'd be surprised if Akramaks didn't ban it, to be honest.
Akramaks are looking for another support here. I don't mind the Disruptor. Static Storm, just to deal with both the Omni Knight and the Storm Spirit, provided you catch them in the Pit of Malice.
Disruptor and Silencer would be my top two picks here on the support role. Global Silence does pierce magic immunity, so the Repel won't really be a factor versus the Silencer. Mm-hmm. Wonder what Akramaks goes for, though. Okay, they're going to reveal their core right away. They're going to pick up the Anti-Mage, who many consider to be a counter to the Storm Spirit. Rightly so, because the Mana Void could rip him and his team a new one if he's not careful. But that's where the Repel is going to add some value. That's where a possible Lincoln Sphere on the Storm Spirit this game. I'm thinking if that makes sense. Never mind, I'm going to take that back. I don't think he's going to need one. You probably just want to rush the Bloodstone Kaya and then consider getting either a Yule Scepter or finishing up a Scythe of Vice after. The problem is, Anti-Mage, if he gets an Aghanim Scepter, is going to have so many ways to defend versus that Storm and that Witch Doctor this game. But it's greedy, right? Anti-Mage and Tinker, both potential split pushers, both heroes that thrive by pushing out the waves and farming in deep positions. Marksman has ways to catch them.
Yeah.
They did ban out the Disruptor, though. Marksmen banned it out themselves, which means Akramaks have to consider the Silencer pick. They did choose to ban the Lifestealer. While Akramaks are actually dipping right into the reserve clock, by the way. They had just 3 seconds to pick, and they'll go with the Venge as their final pickup. Ooh, I'm not a fan of this, to be honest. I mean, you've got the swap to go through a Repel, but
yeah, the swap is gonna help those caught in the Dismember. I don't think Dismember is a huge spell, but it's irritating. And if the Pudge does somehow get close enough to you and is not taking damage, you got the swap.
Also the fact that swap will help to cancel the Witch Doctor's Death Ward if he's going to be channeling up with the Repel.
With the Repel, yeah.
But the projectile stun, it's not entirely convincing versus the Storm. Storm does have a fairly long cast point on the ball lightning, but a preemptive cast would be able to dodge it.
Last pick here for the Marksman, and it's going to be the Juggernaut.
Yeah, I can get behind this. They've got this subtle heal lineup coming out with the Witch Doctor, Omni Knight, and Juggernaut. Yeah. It's good sieging potential with the Blade Fury and the Auto Attacks, and they've got a way to deal with the Tinker and the Storm Spirit.
But they're sort of going to end early.
Yeah, they definitely do.
40-minute mark, beyond that, things just look extremely ridiculous.
You can't afford to go late game versus the Anti-Mage and the Tinker.
Mm-hmm. I'm also looking at the Trilene coming out from the Akramaks. Anti-Mage, Venge, and Nightstalker. I don't think this Omni Knight is going to get away with as much as he's expecting.
If you're the Marksman, you definitely run the offensive dual lane with the Pudge and the Omni Knight.
Okay.
That lane squashes regardless of who comes ahead. If they decide to send the Anti-Mage on the off lane with his supports, Underlord is going to get decimated with that duo. If they decide to send the tri-lane with the Nightstalker, Anti-Mage, and the Venge, Omni Knight and Pudge are going to be just fine. In fact, they'll score kills in that lane. Marksmen have outdrafted their opponents in the laning stage, no matter which way you look at it, as long as the Itachi God and Mage move together. But what's happening here? They're swapping again, because Red is handling the Juggernaut here.
Huh. Well, it is their last time on the main stage, and Red's dying request is to play the one position once, it seems.
Maybe they'll swap once again, though, when they get into the game.
Yeah. I don't know who they're fooling with these swaps. Nobody's falling for it. But yeah, it's Kiko on the mid role. Make Believe is going to be playing the safe lane, which is what he played last time around when they took on the Yakshas, when they had some success. Make Believe seemed to work reasonably well as a one position, which is what he did start out as in this tournament. And this is what he'll go out as well. One position, Anti-Mage.
Unless they're going to swap again. All right, looks like they're going to hold the fort with their current lineup. Mage has gone back to the Juggernaut, by the way, so we're going to see... the Itachi God Pudge and the Zark Storm Spirit.
Okay.
All right, a quick introduction for those of you that have missed it so far.
Hold on. I have to restart my Dota.
Versus Marksman. And while Vivek catches up into the game, I'm going to quickly introduce the side of Marksman. Pudge is going to be handled by Itachi God. Juggernaut is going to be in the hands of Mage. Storm Spirit is going to be handled by Zark. Omni Knight going to be played by Red, and that puts Witch Doctor in the hands of Pashu. On the other side, Akramaks, you've got Make Believe playing the Anti-Mage, Nightstalker, courtesy Blue Frog, Underlord by Dream. Venge is going to be in the hands of Max, and that puts Tinker in the hands of Kiko.
Yeah, for those of you just tuning in on YouTube, wondering why you're looking at pretty much nothing, it's simply because my Dota just bugs out every time I load in. Apologies for that. Okay.
GLHFs have been thrown out. No one's going to pull off those dirty shenanigans. Finally, they've learned, right?
Yeah.
Just going and taking their own bounty rune instead of going for the enemy bounty runes.
I think that's one of... it's one of the biggest things to take away from Ucypher, that just by playing the patch, just by playing often with reasonably competitive teams, you do learn and you grow. And that's my big takeaway here, the growth that each team has taken over the process of these 30 days. And what's exciting is that a lot of these legends of yore are coming back to Dota 2. I'm not going to give you any spoilers here, but be prepared to see names from 1999 popping back in the Dota 2 circuit.
I mean, that's a time before Dota even existed, by the way. Anyway, we're going to see Mage being left to the bottom lane with Pashu and Dream. And yeah, they're running this dual lane with the Omni Knight and the Pudge. Meanwhile, bottom, Dream's already being run down here. They did throw out the paralyzing casks. They shouldn't be able to get this kill on him, but they'll force him to back away and use the salve.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least I hope he'd use the salve here. Up top, Omni Knight. He did start with the D-Gen aura, which is quite confusing to say the least. But it's working because Blue Frog is woefully out of position.
Mm-hmm.
Red's even got the Orb of Venom to work with. So they've got the Rot slow, the Degen Aura slow, and the Orb of Venom slow here. As soon as they get a point in Repel, Itachi God, what the hell are you doing?
Yeah, without Purification or Repel, securing a kill is hard. Giving one away is a lot easier. And with the Void, they're going to get the kill on Itachi God. Now, Red is hanging around with Degen Aura.
That's not how you play the dual lane.
That is not how you play the dual lane. Heck,
terribly
put
done.
The point into repel, out purification, anything else but degen aura.
I mean, if you have the point in degen aura, you don't go rotting out as a Pudge. Was that a lack of communication from them, or was it just overconfidence?
I think it's a misplay.
Either way, it gets punished. Mage on the bottom lane, he's got himself boots, he's got himself a Tango, no Quelling Blade picked up just yet, which means he's going to have a hard time last hitting versus Dream in this one-on-one. Mm-hmm. Pashu, he's going to pull the creep wave to reset the equilibrium. This will help get the lane back in control a little bit. I mean, Underlord's got a good 7 and 3 CS. He's actually out CSing the Juggernaut in this lane.
Yeah. I mean, the previous patch was all about how 4s and 5s roamed across the map. This patch has a lot to do with how 4s and 5s control lane equilibrium, which is why, in my opinion, I'm almost okay if offlaners prioritize blocking that small camp rather than getting a ward, which gives them a little bit of vision on the side. Mm-hmm. Right now, they aren't doing a very good job versus the Underlord because he's getting a lot out of his lane. Heck, he has as much CS as his one position.
Middle lane though, Blue Frog's wrapping around and Zark is so far up the slope, he's probably going to end up dying for this. Kiko fires out the homing missiles. They catch an illusion on the back, but Blue Frog finishes the job on Zark. Kiko, he's going to be very comfortable with that one. Storm does have a TP, however, the creep wave is now still on top of Kiko's slope, which means if Nightstalker just wants to wrap around once more, they could find another kill on Zark. Yeah. Look at him, man. He's disrespecting him. He's just walking all the way out, but this time a Radiant Observer will spot out the Nightstalker.
Mm-hmm. He's moving towards the top lane where Red, as well as Itachi Guard, haven't gotten much done. Red now has the point in Purification. So they could try and turn this around. Itachi God, what are you doing? He's setting up a decent purification, but they could just run down the Pudge. 250 HP, if Make-Believe wants to commit, it'd be mighty silly of him, and he's just going to back off.
I mean, Make-Believe ended up taking almost as much damage as Itachi God there.
Yeah.
Took two hits from the tower, a smack from Red. But so far, I think it's Akramaks that are in the driver's seat. The laning stage hasn't quite panned out as Marksmen would have wanted it to. No one on the side of Akramaks has died. Two kills on the side of Marksmen.
Yeah. One on the Pudge, one on the Tinker, one on the Storm. On the side of Akramaks. Yeah, that's what. Good start here. And we did speak of how the Marksmen are the ones that should be looking to end this game early, if at all.
Anti-Mage has been getting a lot of farm here on this lane. When you run two heroes versus a tri-lane, you want to make sure that the Anti-Mage isn't farming and that you're possibly getting some kills.
Yeah, this dual lane really hasn't worked. I mean, Pudge, okay, now he's going to make it work. The hook is there on a Max. Purification follow. Make-Believe can try his best, but Max is certainly dead.
Yeah, Make-Believe is forced to blink out. Finally, this dual lane is coming online.
Yeah.
Red, he puts a second point into the Purification. I kind of get why he did that, but maybe the repel would have added a bit more value.
The extra damage back there. Anyway, Dream. The Blade Fury is there from Mage. Not sure if he has enough damage. Blue Frog doesn't have mana for another Void. You got the Firestorm. Can Blue Frog really chase? Now, it is nighttime, but without mana, that kill seems unlikely. Heck, Itachi got TPs in even.
Max is here under cover of a smoke as well. He's a little late to the party. While top lane, Red, he's okay versus the Omni Knight. He's got the creep wave under his tower. He's up to level 4 now. That point's available in the repel as well.
Yeah.
Although it's a little unsettling that Itachi got rotated towards the bottom lane and got nothing done. But now he's going to spot out Blue Frog. No, he actually doesn't spot him. Because he heads to the low ground just as Blue Frog walks up to the high ground.
They are positioning for the Tinker. And Itachi God, he's done the smart thing to some extent. Even if he ends up dying here, he is sort of avoiding the death on the Storm Spirit. But look at this. Laser, Rocket, Void. Zark is dead. Itachi God doesn't find the kill in response. Maybe with the tower. Yes, he will. Max still chasing here.
What's Max doing? He could end up dying here. So Frog, Itachi can turn. He's got the hook available now.
They get the Storm Spirit. They lose the Night Stalker. I think they're going to be okay with that.
Yeah. Tranquil Boots online for the Pud, so he doesn't have to make a trip back. He can just wait here, lead some EXP and try and find a counterplay once the Storm comes back in. They've also got Witch Doctor rotating towards the middle lane, and this hasn't been spotted. If they start with the casks, they could get the kill, but Kiko's going to back away. How's Red doing on the top lane? 28 CS on the Anti-Mage, 17 on Red. He's doing all right. And now Max has been spotted. He's going to take a couple of hits from that hammer. Preemptive stun thrown down there. Blue Frog's actually chasing Red. He does have mana, but the Arcane Boots turns with the Purification. Zones out two supports by himself. And, well, to add a cherry on top, he's even got the Shrine. Mid's where the action's at, though. Kiko is consistently pushing out the wave with that one point in the march. And because of that, Pashu and Itachi God can't quite get in range to make a kill happen.
Yep. Zaka. Level 5, no infused raindrops. It's going to at least soak up some of the heat-seeking missile damage. It's going to need them soon enough. But look at this. Pashu and Itachi got smoked up in the mid lane. Itachi got trying to do an Acme here, but it's not going to be too successful.
Little strange that Pashu didn't go out there first.
Yeah, Pashu goes in, throws out the cast. Now he's in a little bit of trouble. The march is there, but Blue Frog forced to fly away. The Maledict upon the Night Stalker. Red even leaves the off lane. TP's to the mid lane, and everybody's just looking at each other here.
This is space for the Anti-Mage to keep farming on the top lane. Make-Believe will be happy with the fact that Red has left him alone.
Yep.
If nothing else, for at least one creep wave.
Juggernaut doing a little better in the last hit department here as compared to the Anti-Mage. Leading by a good 10 CS and leading by a little bit of net worth as well.
Yeah, but I think the problem with that is Underlord is also leading in terms of net worth and CS as compared to the Omni Knight.
Yep.
So it's kind of evening out. And I'm a little worried that the Underlord is getting this much farm. That's going to be an early Arcane Boots, possibly early Mech as well.
Mm-hmm.
Once the Mech comes online, good luck killing them off. He's also going to be the ideal candidate to pick up a Pipe of Insight, which means that the Storm gets rendered effectively useless.
Yep.
Think about it, an Anti-Mage with Spell Shield and a Pipe thrown upon him, what the hell is the Storm expected to do?
I mean, if you're a Storm, you're hoping you get an early Orchid before the Anti-Mage completes his Manta style. But with the kind of start that Zark has had in the mid lane, I just don't see it happening. I mean, how do you feel about the Kaya this game?
On the Storm?
On the Storm.
It's necessary.
Okay.
But I don't know if it's necessary before the Blade Mage. Itachi got hesitated there for a moment.
Yeah, Make-Believe got hooked. He's quick to blink away. The cask follows. Red looking for that Purification, not going to find it. This is the second smoke coming up from Itachi God and Pashu, and it's resulted in nothing. For now, the TPing to the bottom lane, where they're running down the Juggernaut. He's going to TP away. Max stun doesn't have it.
Good escape there from the Jug. Mage manages to bail in time. No kills happening across the map, but Itachi God is still looking. He's hoping to find someone. Make-Believe won't die with a hook here. He's got 3 points in the blink and one in the spell shield. So a hook and a purification aren't going to be enough to finish him. He's got about 780 HP.
I have mixed feelings about this Pudge. They haven't run a hugely successful offensive dual lane. Neither has he just hung around mid trying to secure the runes for the Storm. I mean, Tinker has complete rune control. One of the benefits of the changes to hook is that you can at least secure runes to some extent. And he's doing neither. He isn't applying pressure in this top lane. He's been trying to.
Yeah, honestly, the only Pudge that's been impressive in this entire tournament so far has been Acme.
Yeah.
Itachi God still just wasting time here, not getting anything done, leeching EXP. Finds Max, though, who walks straight into him and gets caught with the rod. Max should go down here.
Yeah.
Nope, never mind. Max survives as well because Tinker rotates in and drops a laser upon him. That just happened. That's a Venge who was walking around with just one magic stick.
Yeah.
Nothing else.
Meanwhile, they did manage to bring down the Underlord. Omni Slash was committed. So the Marksmen are finding something across the map.
Kiko's also got his BOTs. So this is when things are going to get supremely difficult on the side of Marksman. I mean, Zark doesn't have a point in the electric vortex, so he's not going to be able to lock down the Tinker by himself. And if he tries to jump the Tinker, all he's really got to do is turn and hit him with a laser. That'll render the overload charges ineffective, and Kiko should be able to score a return kill. Pashu's at level 6, though. Maybe this is a window of opportunity to try and score another kill on the Underlord.
Yeah, they've got to kill the Underlord more often. This is possibly the easiest... on paper, the easiest kill that they could hope for. Instead, they're trying for the Anti-Mage once more. Itachi God walks in and...
I mean, going for the Anti-Mage when your lockdown sources are so unreliable. Pashu with the slow cast time on that, or rather cast point on that coconut, and Pudge with the unreliable hook dismember.
Yep.
But Max is out there. And
this
he could be taken apart. Red's just man-fighting his way through Make-Believe, while Blue Frog and Max are going to rotate around here. They'll start with a vengeful magic missile. They'll jump forward, but they won't be able to clean house. Itachi, looking for the hook, hesitates once, finds the second one, though, and Max will end up paying the price.
Okay, small victories here. They're forcing the Storm to TP as well. Maybe now, if they do manage to catch the anti-mage, they could bring him down. But Storm just walks into lane and shows himself, if I'm not mistaken, and make-believe is just going to run right back.
See a blink away from make-believe. He's got himself so treads as well as...
Storm ditches the mid lane. Kiko sees this as an opportunity to apply pressure with BOTs and maxed out March of the Machines. This tier 1 tower needs to have someone defending it.
Mage, he's going for the Battle Fury himself. So it's going to turn into this war of attrition where both cores are just going to be farming away, hoping to find the net worth advantage. But I think Anti-Mage takes the cake in that department because of the mobility.
Mm-hmm. So Dream is going for a 4-star first on the Underlord. Mm. Huh.
Does that make sense in any universe?
I don't know. Maybe he's just hoping to keep someone alive. Not sure who.
I can't agree with that.
Maybe keep himself alive?
I just don't agree with the first item 4-star. I guess his approach to this is there's a lack of lockdown on the side of the Radiant, which is why mobility would help. But an early mech, that's invaluable.
Yeah, it is. If you have an early mech, you can group up earlier. Speaking of grouping up, Red, Itachi, God, and Pashu, once again, they won this anti-mage. This time, the Dismember is there, the Cast to Follow, the Maledict as well, heck, even the Death Ward. They bring down make-believe. They've been trying to get this done for the past 5 minutes. Finally, they succeed. Meanwhile, mid lane, Zark needs to be careful here. Zips, hoping to dodge the heat-seeking missile, but Blue Frog is here with the Crippling Fear, forces out the Haste Rune, forces out a bunch of TPs as well. Can Itachi, God, get the hook that he's looking for?
Zark is still thinking about going in, but this is the lost cause. There's a dire observer that's watching him running about. I mean, that top lane, if that happened to an anti-mage in an SEA pub game, all of us would have typed slow fingers la. He shouldn't have died. Pudge walked up to him and dismembered him.
Yeah.
That but delayed his Battle Fury by a bit, but he's still making progress towards it. I mean, let's face it, a 13-minute Battle Fury is pretty standard for a free-farming anti-mage. He hasn't hit that mark. He's at 80 CS 13 minutes in, and to some extent, the pressure has worked from the Pudge and the Omni Knight.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying once more, though. Make believe. He's just going to chop down trees in the vicinity so that he has vision on the sidelines. But Itachi God, still in fog, if he finds this hook. Nope, he's just going for the dismember. The cast will start. I've seen this movie before. And it's going to have a similar ending this time around as well. The Maledict will kill him. And Max is going to come in to die as well. Marksmen find themselves some easy pickoffs here. Good execution coming out with Pashu from the fog, throwing out those casks. This time around, I don't think the anti-mage could have survived.
Yeah, well done there. Cask into dismember. Blue Frog just running around in the nighttime, not there to help his one position. Underlord not even bothering to TP, trying to farm that 4-star.
Which is honestly ridiculous.
I mean, it's going to keep him alive versus the Juggernaut, but really? Mid lane though, Kiko as well as Blue Frog trying to get an early tier 1. Knowing that Zark did leave the mid lane, they're going to apply some pressure.
They're probably not going to get it because Zark is coming in from behind, and from the front side, you've also got the Witch
Itachi
Doctor.
Itachi God, he's making his TP towards the mid lane. Blue Frog did scout it out. Itachi God, can he get the hook? Blue Frog turns around, gets the silence off. Zark is here, zips forward. Does have a point in the electric vortex.
Oh,
but
Blue Frog's down on the cliff. He's in the river, but
does Itachi God see him? Oh, Itachi God, he's going for the
Kiko.
Tinker.
Cancels his TP and sidesteps the hook. I'm not sure if the hook was out of range, but it looked like he was going to connect on him.
Yeah. Meanwhile, I think Dream has forced out an Omni Slash and uses the forced off to get away on the Underlord.
He's also got the Dark Rift available if they want to start making some cheeky plays.
Now he's going for the mech. Top lane, Kiko just walks up to the Omni Knight, forcing him to TP back. 7-4, 15 minutes in, a 1,000 net worth lead.
The arms race has officially begun because the Juggernaut's picked up his Battle Fury. So he started out farming the Anti-Mage. He's got himself a bit of a head start. The Tinker's doing fine though. Kiko's almost got his Blink Dagger online. How's the Storm looking? He does have the point in the electric vortex, so they can go for the kills on the Tinker if they spot him. Mm-hmm. Zark's also rushing the Kaya instead of the Bloodstone. Max, with an Invis rune, does see Zark on the side, so they're not going to be able to get a pick off on the bottom side of the map here. While Itachi, God, and Pashu are under a dire observer ward on the top side.
So, one of the few things that is working really well for the Marksman is that Mage has had uncontested farm. And he's out-farming the anti-mage right now in terms of net worth. Nobody's bothered to gank this Juggernaut. And we've seen in the past what Mage can do with that Juggernaut. Gets that early blink, tries to just jump into the midst of battle and slash heroes down.
Mage still has room to grow as well. I mean, he's got himself one more point on the crit to be picked up.
Yeah.
And he's going for the Yasha next, so the mobility is going to be coming out in his favor as well. Mm-hmm. Top tier one's going to be defended by this Tinker, who should now be picking up the blink dagger in the next 10 seconds or so.
Yeah, he's got a blink dagger complete. Kiko doing really well in the mid lane. Make believe not doing too bad either. And this is when they can start to apply some pressure across the map. Move into lane, spam march, force out rotations.
Pashu and Itachi got though. They've been running around the map for so long, they haven't got anything done, but because of the pressure, they're going for the tier 1 on the top lane. Tinker's going to TP in and blink away. Another defense successfully mounted. No tier 1s have fallen just yet. We're almost 18 minutes into this game. This is a bit surprising to say the least.
I mean, I'm okay with Akramaks playing this passive style of play. I mean, you want to take things late with the anti-mage. The more and more later this goes, the stronger he gets. But the problem is that the Marksmen, I don't know what's the game plan for them. They've planted three heroes top. Zark has just been trying to farm up that Kaya, which he's now completed. He's going for the Yules next. At least that's what he's queued up.
If you're on the side of Marksmen, I think you pop a smoke and try and hunt for someone right now. Put that Kaya to use, put the early level advantage you've got to use. Let the Juggernaut split push. Because if the Tinker comes to fight, the Juggernaut's going to take a tower elsewhere. Red's also gone for the Midas, so they're clearly... Oh, close shave there. Yeah, Red's got the Midas, so this is them gearing up for a potential late game battle.
Mm-hmm. Make Billy meanwhile just back those and takes down the tier 1. At mid, TPs are coming in. Mage looking for that Omni Slash. He has a Battle Fury to go with it. He's trying to bait out the 4 staff. But at the end, just pops the Blade Fury and TPs mid to continue farming.
But that's a trade that's going to go in favor of the Marksman. Because mm-hmm. they get a tier 1 on the middle, on the bottom lane, as well as a tier 1 on the top.
Sub lane.
Just barely misses Kiko. Zips once again. Another blink from Kiko. He's going to TP out while Zark's lost all of his mana.
He's got a regen rune.
But when the Tinker's preoccupied elsewhere, Mage sees this as an opportunity to take a tier 1 in the middle lane.
Yeah, they're making this Tinker work. But Blue Frog's here. Mage does have the Blade Fury. Pops it. The healing ward dealt with.
Why didn't he silence first?
Yeah, the Crippling Fear should have come out first. Maybe that could have been a kill. Meanwhile, top lane is zipping in for make believe. Both teams are getting a little impatient now.
Zark tried to zip in on the anti-mage there. Perhaps if he started with the electric vortex, he'd have got him. But I think he went for the auto attack after the ball lightning.
Look
first.
At this smoke rotation coming up from the Akramaks. Now there is a Radiant Observer, so they're not catching any of this. Blue Frog just goes in, there's the Crippling Fear, the hook will miss, the Pit of Malice catches the Pudge. Blue Frog pounding away on him, quick purification, hoping to keep him alive. Meldict upon the Underlord. Both teams bump into each other and run away, but Zark wants to go in, zips forward. Kiko quick with the blink. Zark using a lot of mana ineffectively just for a Night Stalker. Doesn't even get that kill, and now Zark forced to retreat. Blue Frog surging forward, does have another Void. But I do not think they can go any further.
Red's body blocking Itachi God. He can't find a line for the hook because Red is trying to walk forward. I'm not sure what the hell is going on here.
Itachi had a fantastic line for it. Mage with the Omni Slash goes in, gets Blue Frog, looks for more. The hook doesn't connect. In fact, it connects on a Storm Spirit who zipped ahead. And the Rockets do kill the Pudge. Kiko looking for more. Make Believe blinks forward. One Zark. Make Believe doesn't have the mana void for. He has committed it. He's still giving chase though. The Coconuts buying Zark some time. Make Believe could blink to the high ground, but there's a healing ward there trying to keep the Storm Spirit alive. I'm sure Make Believe can get this kill all by himself, but he's making Zark really work hard here. Just zips and DPs away.
I mean, That was some of the worst coordination I've seen coming out from the side of Akramaks. From the side of Marksmen in a long time, man. Red was busy body blocking the Pudge for a good 10 seconds in that fight. When he does get a hook, he ends up hooking the Storm, who didn't communicate that he was going in either.
So they got the Omni Knight, they got the Pudge. They didn't lose. I think they lost Blue Frog. Blue Frog died to the Omni Slash, if I'm not mistaken.
An absolute symphony of fails coming out there from the Radiant. Got a disconnect coming out on the Nightstalker though. Hopefully he's going to be jumping back into this game ASAP. The admins are on it.
Mm-hmm. Still a 2,000 net worth advantage in favor of the Marksman. And I'm sure a lot of this is coming primarily through Mage on the Juggernaut, who's 2K ahead of the Anti-Mage, of the Tinker. Doing really well for himself. Should be having that Manta style soon enough, and that Crippling Fear won't mean too much.
Yeah. The Manta style is definitely going to be a useful tool in his arsenal, but
yeah.
At the same time, Tinker's making some good progress as well. He's got about 1400 gold picked up. Anti-Mage is sitting at 1100, so the Manta's still a ways off. How's the Jog looking though?
The Juggernaut.
Is he going to get a Blink Dagger next, or do you think he's going to get himself an Abyssal this game? I think it's the Blink.
He does like to pick up the Blink early.
That smoke might have just been spotted on the middle lane. There was the a Marksman on the smoke? High ground. Yeah, Mage, his smoke has been dispelled now because he just out ran the lane. But
anyway, they're just walking into the mid lane hoping to take a tower. It's Itachi God's time to shine. Possibly he can get the hook, which could set up his team real nice here. Mage is running it through the march, deep zip coming out from the Storm Spirit, doesn't find Kiko, zips further, finds Blue Frog. Blue Frog just flies over the cliff. And once again, Storm expending mana, not getting too much done.
Questionable stuff coming out from the side of Marksman. I mean, they're feeling confident to take these fights, but they're giving up a lot in exchange. Dream is pushing out top, Make Believe is ratting a tier 1 in the bottom lane. And they could come back to fight at a moment's notice. Witch Doctor TP's himself up top. He should be able to get this deny off on the tower with Paralyzing Cask to slow this down, and Red in the vicinity as well. Bottom lane, Mage. He's confident of taking the fight one-on-one versus that Anti-Mage.
So yeah, he's queued up the
Make Believe needs to bail. Slow and steady build-up as we enter the mid-game stage here. 22 minutes in, the score sitting at just a meager 8-6. And only a couple of towers have fallen down so far. All tier 1s have dropped, but tier 2s, not so much as a scratch on them.
Underlord has completed the mech since that early first half, which did allow him to survive an Omni Slash.
Kiko not getting spotted out either. I think it's time you start putting those. Okay, they have put the Tinker Wards as well.
Yeah, there is one Tinker Ward on the top lane.
Zark is skipping the Bloodstone altogether. I'm not a fan of this at all on the Storm Spirit.
I mean, he's going for the Yules to deal with the Crippling Fear. It would also be nice. I mean, it might help set up kills when he zips in that aggressively.
Looking
it's
back,
an odd way of playing Storm. I mean, Storm does more damage if he has more mana or mana regen. Bloodstone gives you that. This time around, he's gone for survivability and some mana cost reduction in the form of the Kaya.
You know, usually it's the Akramaks that have the lineup that needs to end early. This time around, it's the tables have turned because Marksmen are the ones that have some pressure on them to end this game. Anti-Mage can just continue ratting and farming with his Manta and Battle Fury. And it's almost impossible to kill him unless you zip in with a Storm, which is so dangerous.
Top lane, Kiko's here. Mage blinks ahead aggressively. They know Kiko's nearby. Kiko is going to be TPing the way back home. Cancels his TP. Now, there is a Tinker Ward. This could go horribly wrong for Kiko.
Red actually repelled a creep in that fight. Silence,
Pit of Malice. Deep zip coming up from Zark. Pulls in the Night Stalker. Immediate Guardian Angel. Who are they targeting here? Mage with the Omni Slash. But it's split by two. And they even pop the mech. He does manage to bring down Blue Frog. And with the Repel, they might have enough to bring down the Underlord. But Make Believe with the Mana Void brings down the Storm. Moves on to Red. And Red will fall as well. Mage Repel upon him. His Blink continuously being disabled here. And the Witch Doctor drops the Death Ward. But Mage has fallen. The Death Ward doing some work versus Kiko. But make believe, cleans house, gets a triple kill. Surgically, I mean, moving from hero to hero, Zarg bringing each one of them down.
Zarg just disrespects the anti-mage by zipping in time and again so deep. He finished his own mana, anti-mage comes in, one mana void, he rips him a new one and takes the juggernaut down to red HP. Then from there on out, it was just cleanup duty. They end up getting four kills. They lost just the Night Stalker in exchange. The biggest problem is that three of those kills went over to the anti-mage.
Yeah.
Including a killing spree that then went over to Kiko.
Yeah. Three kills to anti-mage, a death on the juggernaut, and now the network graph. It's back at dead even. That was one costly fight for the marksman.
Yeah, I'd say Akramaks are comfortably in the driver's seat after that one.
Yeah.
Make-believe is at 2.6k gold. If he goes for the Basho, I wouldn't fault it. If he goes for the Aghanim Scepter, I'd be pretty happy. I think he should be going for the Aghanim Scepter this game. Mm-hmm. I don't think you go for the Basho.
Versus right the Storm and...
Hold Storm, on. Pudge, Witch Doctor,
do
all...
Do you return Omni Slash?
I don't think so, no. I hope not. Actually, maybe.
What happens then? I don't know. I haven't seen it.
Turns into one of those Dragon Ball Z sort of fights, you know, where they just disappear. And if your eyes aren't fast enough, you can't follow it. I've seen it with Rubik and the Juggernaut. There's like a staff and a sword that are just going round and round in the air.
Dream now has the Vanguard complete. He's going to be picking up the Crimson Guard, which is going to do a lot of good versus the Juggernaut. It's also going to do a lot versus the Death Ward, which is physical damage.
Make believe. He's going for the Lincolns, not the Aghanim Scepter.
Ah, come on, go Ags. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think the Ags would have been better, yeah.
Well,
imagine,
they are...
man, the ability to return the Electric Vortex, the ability to return the casks, the Dismember. Why wouldn't you?
It's much stronger than a Lincoln Sphere. You'd much rather have the Ags Scepter than a Lincoln Sphere.
I agree.
It requires a lot more effort to deal with the anti-mage. Like, I mean, first you got to pop the Ags, and then you got to lock him down. And who is going to probably try and pop the Ags first? Yeah, I'm not even sure.
Check out what's going on, though. Zarg has a repel upon him this time, so they want to make sure that the mana void doesn't destroy them once again. But Dream's going to walk in. Dream is the tankiest hero of the lot, so they can retaliate here if they want
to. They should get this. Medic. Oh,
he's
I said
alive.
They should get
he's
this.
He's Dark Rifting
he's
as
Dark
well.
Rifting back home. The hook is there. It's not going to cancel the Dark Rift, but they do have enough to bring down the Underlord. Kiko did manage to apply some pressure in the mid lane, but they lost the tier 2 at top. A little sloppy coming out from the Akramaks.
Disappointing. They should have gone for that fight.
Yeah.
That's a Vanguard, 4-star, mech, Underlord that got initiated upon with everything they had. They should have gone and fought this.
Absolutely. Make believe they might find a tier 2 in exchange.
But in exchange, they're going to find Rosh on the side of Marksmen. The Akramaks are doing what they do best. They're throwing. Mm-hmm.
Now, Mage doesn't have a TP to get back home if Make Believe decides to go for tier 3s. I don't think the Storm can do it all by himself. Itachi God does have a TP though. Make Believe. Not really sure as to where his opponents are. Just hanging... they caught Blue Frog. They've got the Dismember. They caught him midair, and they're going to bring him down. Kiko with the cover fire. It's not enough. Is that a Greaves now complete? Red does have a Greaves.
So they got Roshan. They got a kill on the Night Stalker.
They got a kill on the Vengeful Spirit.
And they got a kill on the Vengeful Spirit with the Omni Slash and the Storm Zip committed. But they end up losing a Witch Doctor in exchange on the bottom lane, while Make Believe does a little bit of chip damage on the tier 3.
He's got the Axe.
Good job. Yeah, I can get behind the Ags here. But I still think that's a very significant victory coming out on the side of Marksmen. They've got an Aegis on Zarg now, which means that they're ready to fight YOLO.
Yeah. And they've got to fight YOLO.
He's making progress towards the Bloodstone. Yule's is complete as well. You should fight now if you're the Marksmen. We talked about how they're on a clock. Their clock is definitely ticking.
Yeah. This is... You couldn't ask for a better opportunity. You got to group up. Once you have the Omni Slash, once you have the Death Ward, try and look for fights with that Aegis on the Juggernaut. Try and get as much damage done. The problem is that there's a Tinker who's constantly split pushing.
Meanwhile, Jog's chosen to go for a Lincolns of his own, so not entirely sure how much value that'll add, but given that he's got the synergy with the Lincolns and the Manta style, the Night Stalker should no longer be able to lock him down.
Mm-hmm. Still got the Pit of Malice, which is good to some extent, and Night Stalker has to choose as to what spell he wants to commit on the Juggernaut, the Crippling Fear, or the Void.
What's the final item here for the Jug? Basho, Abyssal Blade?
Yeah, he definitely needs an Abyssal Blade.
Problem is, even with the Abyssal Blade, the Anti-Mage is not a target for him. Mm-hmm.
So what are you saying, Diffusal and Abyssal Blade?
Well, complicated question, man. I mean, the Lincolns is one item slot taken away, which ideally he wouldn't have gone for. He's got to hold on to the Blink this game as well, which means he can only get rid of the Ring of Aquila and swap the Phase Boots for BOTs. So it's technically just one item that he can pick up. Yeah. That one item is either going to be an Abyssal Blade, a Diffusal Blade, or a Butterfly.
But, you know, you're talking about that one item. In my eyes, Marksmen need to not even wait for that item. Yeah. They need to try and get as much damage done as early as possible. With the Tinkerbot to the side, they do have Vision for Kiko. This is good stuff coming out from the Marksmen. They are pushing. The Heat-Seeking Missile just tickles with the Healing Ward drop. And they are going to get a Tier 2. Make-Believe is trying his best to rat it out. He has got a TP, so he can join his team. And he's also got a Skull Basher complete waiting for him in base.
Yeah, I think I don't see the value in waiting to pick up that Belt of Strength. But Red chose not to keep going. He actually TP'd back, so that push fizzles out after a Tier 2 tower. Mm-hmm. Is that really the trade you're going to make? An Aegis picked up to only get a Tier 2 tower? That seems like...
and guard upon the tower, it's going to soak up some of the physical damage.
Tinker didn't buy back. This means that the tier 3 is going to fall undoubtedly. Zark's got himself a little more mana to work with. He's got the bottle available and a healing ward's been placed on the floor. The hook will fly and it'll miss. Tier 3, slowly but surely, about to whittle down, and it looks like they're ready to bail after the tower. Not going for the barracks, just blinking and running away. Quick, disciplined plays coming out from the marksman. Mm-hmm. Akramaks, that was the first nail in their coffin.
Yeah, and Kiko's immediately blinked to the top lane to try and split push the lane.
But Mage is already here.
Yeah.
Mage. It's probably a Skadi or a Butterfly at this point. It's the Butterfly. It's got the Eagle Song, got the full Butterfly, in fact, now complete. He's basically unkillable at this point. 34 armor, 2160 HP, Magic Immunity, Dispel, and Evasion.
Make-Believe, he's inching closer and closer to that Abyssal Blade. Is it going to be enough to deal with the Juggernaut who has evasion? Not sure, but he should at the very least try and bring down other targets like the Storm or maybe even the Omni Knight. Speaking of the Storm, he's got the Bloodstone complete, 14 charges as well, 34 minutes in. Along with the Yules and the Kaya, not too bad at the end of it all.
I mean, given that the Soul Ring is no longer a component necessary for the Bloodstone, I'm not sure if Zark really needed to make it this game. Anyway, he's got the Arcane Rune and the Kaya if he wants to make this deep dive onto Dream.
Yeah, this is a kill he can take. If Dream shows himself, yeah, Dream isn't going to. Just going to back away.
Zark still holding on to that Arcane Rune if he wants to pop it. There's a Dire Observer Ward that's watching Itachi God as well. Mm-hmm. But Dream is still here though. He doesn't have a blink or anything to get away quickly. He has the 4 staff. But he doesn't show himself again. Just revealing himself with the Firestorm and then backing away. I don't think they should be waiting here.
Do you think the Tinkle could have played things differently this game in any fashion? Maybe a little more kill participation?
I don't think it's the Tinker's fault per se. I mean, I think Kiko's done... If anything, Kiko's the only one that's done a good job in this entire game.
Okay.
He's been at every single tower, defending when he can. Mage has used the Tinker's movements to take towers in the early game stage, which was mostly Mage's... Well, it's credit to Mage as opposed to discredit to Tinker.
Okay.
What was not too impressive on the side of Akramaks is the silly fights that they've taken time and again. Like, we saw Dream getting caught in the jungle, right? That's when you say, all right, guys, our piece of meat has now been baited. Let's use it.
Yeah.
We have a shrine to TP2. We have a tier 2 to TP2.
We had tier 2s.
Let's get in there and fight. They should have fought that one.
Mm-hmm.
When you make silly decisions like that, and then you end up giving up AN ages after, things start to go horribly wrong. And even though that lineup was meant to fight in the late game, you can see it's struggling quite heavily. Mostly because the Juggernaut has just gone further and further ahead.
Mm-hmm.
And Storm's pretty farmed too. Two shrines now being assaulted simultaneously by the Marksman.
Red is no expensive. Also queued up the Nullifier. I mean, you got to be careful. If you throw it on the Anti-Mage, you just end up nullifying yourself. Blue Frog running down the Omni Knight. They've got the rockets as well as the laser, but a quick defensive hook in the Greaves. And Red is out there. But yeah, you got to be careful with the Nullifier. You got to pop his Aghanim Scepter somehow and then try and use the Nullifier on the Anti-Mage.
Yeah, but a Nullifier on any of these heroes would be nice this game. Not so much on the Venge or the Nightstalker, of course, because they don't really have too many
Yeah, but definitely the Underlord.
Underlord, yeah, it would be fantastic versus the Underlord, actually. Tinker is the ideal candidate to be hit by it, but it's unlikely that Red gets in close for him. Actually, now that you mention it, I'm not sure Red should be building the Nullifier. At this point, I think mobility should be his prime concern. Blink, 4-star. Maybe even a Lotus Orb wouldn't be bad, actually.
Make believe. He's gone in.
Red's got the Repel. He's not going to get bashed up here. I wanted to see Red picking up the Lotus Orb, not the Nullifier, actually. Because you know that the Anti-Mage is going for an Abyssal Blade. Having a Lotus thrown on the Jug with a Linkens who goes up onto the high ground and hits, you're not stopping him.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems as the Marksmen have given the Akramaks a bit of time. I presume this is primarily because the Marksmen are still looking for their second Roshan.
Yeah, which is now online.
You got to get 4 or 5 of them before you win. It's like Pokeball.
I think Marksmen fights with the next Roshan. They should go into the pit right about now and look for it.
Yeah.
Zark, unfortunately, hasn't been able to pick up too many Bloodstone charges after he made it.
He's got the Arcane Rune. But he isn't doing too much with it. Sparshu picked up any new items. He's got the Glimmer Cape. Is there any detection on the side of the Akramaks? Jesus, Blue Frog is pissed poor. He's getting a 4-staff complete.
But, I mean, Make Believe and Tinker are super farmed right now.
Mm-hmm.
Kaya, Ags. Glimmer Cape on Tinker, what?
I do not advocate that.
I'm face palming so hard right now.
I mean, they moved into Roshan. Roshan.
Why would you make a Glimmer Cape on Tinker this game?
I don't know.
I don't get it.
The Omni Slash was the problem.
Get a Yules.
Yules, Eth Blade, anything. I don't know. Anyway, they've got Aegis, they're just moving down mid. Zark with the deep dive, he's caught Blue Frog. Blue Frog didn't manage to buy out his 4-star. But a quick swap from Max ensures that he's the one who falls down. The Omni Slash has been committed. Mage blowing the Omni Slash there for the Ventral Spirit. And now he's popping this Blade Fury to try and take down the barracks. This is through back to protection, but they've got the Repel. They've got the Healing Ward, forcing out the Glyph here and backing out for the time being.
It's time to go in again, though.
The pipe they is are. Oh, they've caught the Underlord. Where's the follow-up? You need the Tinker. You need the Anti-Mage to zip in and join the fight. But they're just going to let the Underlord die. Dream buys back on the Underlord. Make Believe still looking for his opportunity to move into battle. He's got the Eggs. He's got the Abyssal. There isn't a better chance. The Healing Ward's on cooldown. You have got to take this fight now. Or possibly just forfeit barracks.
Yeah, you go in with your Creep Wave now coming in. Go take the barracks, no fortification, Blade Fury into barracks, that's an easy
Zark zips in, he wants Make Believe turns it around, Zark quick to zip away the Repel as well. Secondary hook coming up from Mithachi God, looking for the Underlord, Zark caught in the pit of malice, did pop the cheese in the midst of all that, make believe, returns the nullifier onto red, and we did speak of this. Mage all by himself, isolated, possibly surrounded, and with the swap, he could be going down here. Mage does have the Aegis, make believe, still working hard for it. They've got the hook, they've got Max once more. The mech was there, but the death ward on the side just doing so much damage upon Dream. They'll run down the Underlord. That could be a dieback, and indeed it is. Make believe, forced to run right back. Red low on mana, but Mage, I think his Aegis has... What? His Aegis not even popped over there.
He got a healing ward and a mech along with a purification.
And they're just going for the second lane of barracks. Now, Zarq is going to respawn in 13 with all those Bloodstone charges and they could go once more. No Underlord for 76 seconds. That's the first notable laser I'm seeing in this entire team fight. Make believe jumps in. He wants Itachi God. His axe available. Returns the cast. It's bouncing between red. It's bouncing between the Pudge. Mage trying to run down Blue Frog, who four staffs away. But Zarq, he's caught Blue Frog midair. He'll zip after him and bring him down while make believe he's still struggling to get anything done in these fights. Kiko, he's got the Glimmer Cape. And that's going to ensure survivability for the time being.
So this fight lasted so long, Mage's Omni Slash cooldown over the duration of it.
Yeah, he hasn't even lost Aegis.
I
don't know how the Akramaks hold on. 40 seconds until the Underlord respawns. Make believe trying to get into battle. The Rod of Atos returned onto the Pudge. Make believe he's trying to walk right up to Mage. But the Dismember is there from range. Itachi God with the Aether Lens. Max with the swap, but Max will fall as well. Zarq is here. There's the Abyssal from Make Believe. But he uses it to zip right back, move into his fountain. But the Yule Scepter is there. Itachi God whiffs on the hook. But they've done the damage. The heat-seeking missiles don't do much. The second lane of barracks to fall, and the Akramaks still struggling to figure out how to defend. Mage still has Aegis, still wants to fight. Make believe, tried to lock down the storm there, but wasn't able to.
The Akramaks, I mean, their hope has been crushed. Look at the boys on stage. Their faces have just dropped after that last fight. That's two lanes of barracks in favor of Marksmen. Top lane, it's going to be defended as well. This massive creep wave isn't going to do too much, but a minor dent on their tier 3 tower. And really, all that the Marksmen have to do now is just walk straight through the top lane and finish what they started. They're going to come back with new items. That should be, it's a full moonshot finished up on Mage, by the way. He's still holding on to the bloody Aegis.
It's also a Lincoln Sphere nearly complete on the Storm.
What does he even buy at this point?
The Juggernaut?
Another moonshot, okay. This time he feeds it over to Zarq.
Okay.
So Zarq has a moonshot gifted to him. He's looking for his own next pickup, which is the Lincoln Sphere.
Yeah.
This game is over. Akramaks, I just don't see them coming back from this. I don't know if Red caught that he got nullified himself, but if he did, he really should avoid using it on the Anti-Mage.
Mm-hmm. You could use it on the Underlord.
You should use it on the
Underlord. Disable the Force Staff, disable the mech.
The Underlord or the Tinker. We've maintained that from the start. But Tinker's got some pretty useless items himself.
Oh, like, now he's got the Scyther Wise. This could be enough. I'm not really sure, though.
I doubt it, man. Aegis still on Mage. It should be timing out sometime soon, but... Well, they're going in. Tier 3 is being jumped upon, and...
Oh, Zarq zips in. He catches the Underlord. A Rod of Atos to follow from Itachi God. They are controlling this Underlord.
No Omni Slash committed just yet. That's a dead Underlord for 70 seconds. A hook will find a creep. Red... There was a Hex thrown out, I believe. No, it wasn't. It's a Lincoln Sphere on Red now.
Yeah, Kiko does have the X. The Atos returned. No one on the side of Akramaks feels like going through. But Mage has got the battle started. The Omni Slash manages to secure the kill on the bench. Kiko survives thanks to that Glimmer Cape. And he blinks back to his own fountain. Itachi God pushing back make-believe with the help of the Death Ward. I think the game's come to an end, CloudX. I mean, I don't see how the Akramaks defend. Yeah, I don't even know why they're holding on.
I mean, it is their last game on the stage, and they're going to go out with...
It's not cafe time. You can tap GG.
They're going to go out, though, with grace. I mean, come on, let's give them that. A fourth place finish at Ucypher isn't half bad. I'm going to say Akramaks, the team that has just been getting beaten time and again in Dota, has somehow managed to make it to the fourth spot on account of their other games. But this is where their journey ends. Akramaks will end at fourth, while Marksmen will end at third.
Does Zarq have an Ag Scepter? Okay, I know. I saw two-man electric vortex. Anyway, Zarq, he's going in. He's having fun. Make believe did try his best. And unfortunately, today's best wasn't enough.
No GG is being called, though. No one's going to call GG on the main stage. They're going to keep going at this.
Yeah.
Mega creeps up against them. They managed to get themselves three kills.
They got the bash on Zoc. They could get the skill.
Comeback is real? Nah, come on. This is not happening. I mean, their Ancient is exposed.
Yep.
That was like a 2,000 gold swing on just the death of the Storm Spirit, by the way.
Mm-hmm. I mean, amongst all the one positions, yeah, Mage has definitely been one of the more flawless one positions.
Yeah, he's been impressive.
I've noticed time and time again.
Particularly his Juggernaut. It's been really good.
His Juggernaut is Sven. He's one of those one positions who farms well in lane and also has really strong impact in terms of team fight. If I had to pick a one position of the tournament, in my eyes, it's going to be Mage.
He's just buying moon shards like chocolates now.
What
he's
does he do?
Who do you even give it to at this point? I guess you drop your blink and keep it in your stash.
Yeah. What's he going to do with that moon shard?
I mean, he's got some ridiculous attack speed as it is. Well then, we called it too early. Akramaks are gonna keep fighting here.
Or they called it too late. Anyway, Kiko's got that Glimmer Cape. It did pay off a bit. Allowed him to survive every now and then.
We're still seeing Marksmen hold on to the game though. I mean, they're being disciplined about this. Still grouping up and... Never mind, as
Look
I say
this.
Discipline, what on earth is Zoc up to?
15 mana regen.
He's alright. Time to end the game, boys, Marksman. Please don't wait for another Roshan. Pashu, he's being a little silly here. That's an anti-mage with an MKB and an Abyssal Blade.
He has got a... I admire the effort. A for effort.
Mage,
look at
though.
Mage though. Just running down. Okay.
This is why they're not in the finals.
This stuff I call him the best one position in the tournament. But hey, come on. He thought the slashes would somehow move on to the real anti-mage. Tough luck, Omni Slash wasted.
Now wait for another 90 seconds. Wait till Roshan respawns. He's back in 7. And once again, really, I don't think there's been a single game at Ucypher without at least 3 Roshans, right?
Yeah.
Well, he's back. No one spotted this just yet, though. Red will be the hero that goes in and spots him.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, there is nothing that the Akramaks can do to contest this. They've managed to bring the gold advantage a little bit further down, though. From 30k, it's now down to about 25k.
Okay.
What do they have to show for it?
I don't know. They have an MKB on the anti-mage. They have a Scyther Vice on the Tinker. Is it enough, though?
And now they've got a refresher shot on red, so... They could simply walk in,
and
double Guardian Angel, and finish the game.
Yeah.
And there's nothing they could do about it.
Is that what we're hoping for, him? Yeah? I want to see a clean double GA and just an end to the game.
And he has the Blink Dagger as well to come in at later stage, so...
Mm-hmm.
It's time to go. Creeps have pushed in from bottom. Simply repel Mage and send him in. No, repelling Zoc instead. They're going to go for the fight. Zip
okay.
in.
They want Zoc to fight. They catch the Underlord. Dream. We haven't seen even one Dark Rift this game, but they are trying to go in. They have caught the Witch Doctor. GA comes out. They're zipping in. Mage forces Make-Believe to blink out of there. Now, Omni Knight is running in. A quick swap keeps them alive. Red just chasing them back to their own fountain. Further zip coming out from Zoc. Mage manages to bring down one somewhere on the side while Make-Believe is trying to force down Zoc here. He hasn't got the Mana Void, so Zoc is completely okay, having lost all his mana. There's the Omni Slash. There's the GG. Marksmen take third place in Season 1 of Ucypher.
A big round of applause for the Marksmen. They've got themselves a well-deserved victory today. Akramaks, they just couldn't step up right till the very end.